than Chow form. But he has been doing a lot of constructive algebraic geometry as well as constructive differential algebraic geometry. And he also used algebraic methods for cryptography, automatic geometric reasoning, and other things on the CADs and robotics, and he directs software packages as well. He has written over 130 papers and quite a number of graduate students, doctoral students. Some of them have actually given talks here.
Yeah.
So like Wai Li. And so let's welcome the Gao.
So I appreciate William and Alexei to give me this chance to talk here. The thing I'm going to talk here actually a survey of what I'm doing with my student, the former student Wai Li and Chun Ming Yuan. And in the past more than 5 years, it's a differential, some difference. I will focus mostly on differential, and then I will talk a little bit about difference, Chow forms, sparse resultant, and a toric variety. Outline, first the sparse differential resultant, differential Chow form, and the last topic is mostly difference, binomial, ideal, and toric orality. Resultant. So resultant, we all know that start with this paper by Sylvester in 1883. So this is this is a very long paper. People don't know, this is a very, very long paper. Many properties are studied for this looks very simple. Sylvester resultant. Of course, the most important property of the resultant is that the resultant of Fg is zero. It gives a sufficient and necessary condition for the two equations to have common solutions. So this is the simplest case. And the other way, my colleague in 1902 extended this resultant to the multivariate case. And more recently, Galfond and his colleagues, and also Sternfields, they extended this multivariate resultant to sparse resultant. So in the differential case, Reid in his first book, not in the second book, but in the first book, studied differential resultant in the case of N equal to 1. I think he basically proved the existence, but he did not give the detailed properties that was similar to what was done in Sylvester's paper. In more recent years, some people try to extend this to multivariate case, but most of the work are not really work. For example, Farrell's work, Carl Farrell wrote several papers, but it seems that she did not notice. So according to her definition, in most cases, for every nonlinear differential polynomial, the determinant is always zero, so basically it gives nothing. I noticed that in this handbook of differential equations in a chapter, they also said that differential resultant can be done similarly in a matrix form, similar to what was done in the algebraic case, but that's actually, I believe, is a mistake, because until now, I will say later, we still do not have a matrix formula for differential resultant. But for difference resultant, we do have a matrix formula. I will say that later. And for sparse, of course, this is very intuitive to say what sparse means. So for non-sparse or dense, for the dense case, basically we have for a polynomial. Here we have one variable and the other one. We have all the terms with a degree less than, in this case, less than or equal to 5. For sparse, basically, it means we only have several fixed monomials. For this example, we have the non, we have this non-constant term, and y to the power of 4, and y prime to the power of 5. That's that point, and here is this point. So we have fixed monomials. That means by what we mean by sparse. So here, I believe most people know this very well, so I just quickly repeat it. We consider ordinary case, because in the partial partial case, you basically cannot get one polynomial. You will get a system of polynomials, then the properties are not that neat. So we consider ordinary case, and the determinants are always denoted by y 1 to yn, and this notation. We will use the Laurent case, because in the sparse case, to consider Laurent or non-Laurent basically the same. Because we will know, we consider Laurent monomial is always written into this in this form. So here's the power dkl is belong to z. That means what we mean by Laurent. Then Laurent polynomial, the support of f is basically the monomial. Sometimes we mean is power. It's a power vectors. The Laurent polynomial ring. Here are a very simple example. This is a differential polynomial. By Laurent, it means we can move y1 to y1 minus something like this. It's allowed. Negative exponent is allowed. That's the Laurent. So because it's very, very difficult to have a matrix formula. My colleague studied resultant, multivariate resultant, by just simply gave the resultant formula. He very ingeniously gave this matrix formula, and then he proved that this matrix has a non-zero determinant, and one of the factors is the resultant. But in differential case, that's very tricky, because when you do a differentiation to a monomial, it becomes very complicated. That's the reason. So the other way to define resultant is to use a kind of intersection theory. The main difficult to define the multivariate differential resultant is that the differential dimension intersection theorem I write here, this is true in every case, but it's not true. That's not true in differential case. The rate gives a very, very tricky example. But we did prove something that was basically we show that this was true in the generic case. That let I be a prime differential ideal with dimension d and order h. So f be a generic differential polynomial. By that I mean it's a coefficients are also indeterminates of order s and uf. Then this ideal i1, let's intersect f with i, is still a prime differential ideal. Let's consider it in this polynomial ring. We put the coefficients as uf in the coefficient side. Let's still consider it as a polynomial of y. Then it has dimension d, exactly d minus 1. And then order h plus s. This is true in the generic case. But it's not true if u is a specific differential polynomial. So this using this so we can give the generic dimension theorem, which compared to the dimension conjecture, which means that f1 and f1, the dimension, if it's not empty, then the component has a dimension larger than or equal to n minus r. So basically shows this is true generically. For generic polynomials, f1 and fr, so the ideals generated by them are of dimension n minus one, n minus r, and order, also order is exactly order sum of all the polynomials. So this gives the basis to define the resultant. to define a sparse differential resultant, we have n variables. We need to consider n plus 1 differential polynomials. So that's ai from 0 to n be n plus 1 sets of differential monomials.
Xing. Sorry.
Denoted by m. So we consider generic differential polynomials pi with the coefficient uij, which are also differential indeterminates. So here then we have a differential ideal generated by p0 to pn, which belong to this mixed differential polynomial ring. For u, for the coefficients, we consider it as an ordinary differential polynomial. But for y, we consider it a Lorentz. That's quite natural, because for y, in the sparse case, it's not guaranteed that there is a constant term. So basically, all the variables are treated as is equivalent if you divide one variable by. I try to explain why using Lorentz case. So anyway, it's equivalent. In algebraic case, it's also done in this way. So what we do is we consider this elimination ideal. We consider the intersection of this ideal p0 to pn with a coefficient ring. That's the ring of all the coefficients of the differential polynomial pi, u0 to un. And it defines a resultant in the case if this intersection elimination ideal is of co-dimension 1. In that case, it's well known that a differential ideal of co-dimension 1 can be always written in this form. It can be written in the saturation ideal of a polynomial R of U0 and UN. And we can show that R is irreducible. This is the prime ideal. And this happens even only if these PIs, we call it Lorentz differentially essential. By that I mean there exists KJ for each 0 to n. That means that we select each pair of monomial from each polynomial of PI, and then we consider this differential field. Then this is all about u0 to un. So if the differential transcendental degree of this differential field over q is a rational number equal exactly to n, since this happens if and only if this elimination ideal is of co-dimension 1, then can be written defines one polynomial. And this polynomial, I said, it can be proved is irreducible. This defined to be the sparse differential resultant of p0, pn, or we can say is the sparse resultant of the monomial or the support of pi, because there's the support, the monomials are the essential part. So these are the most, I believe, is the most general case that you can define a resultant. usually, people consider other conditions due to reasons, because in this case, some strange phenomena can happen. But anyway, this is a general case to define a sparse resultant.
Sorry, Shan, I didn't get this last statement, so it's quite long. So this equivalence is what? It's a sparse differential result.
This is true. If and only this is true.
The black, the statement.
This is of co-dimension 1. Co-dimension 1 is true even only if this differential transcendental degree is equal to 1. These are equivalent.
What is the significance of these quotients?
Pardon me?
What, in the m divided by the m's?
What you need to consider somehow that's to homogenize to you cannot only consider one monomial. You need to consider the quotients of the polynomial, because in that you see in the sparse case each term of the polynomial pi always has a monomial, and then you can multiply anything to pi, then you get a different set of support, but all these support are essentially the same. So you need to make a quotient to get rid of those extraneous factors. Otherwise, it's not true. This statement is not true. So basically, we define the resultant. Also, this seems the easiest way to define a resultant. If you're using the matrix form, so you need a lot of proof. Need a lot of techniques to prove the determinant is not zero.
So let's fix one of the equations. So that means I fixed an I, right?
Yeah.
And so I pick
from
here,
right?
So each one. So that the first one is from a zero. The second one is from a one, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm taking in your top a sub I, I'm taking m sub I1 divided by m sub I0, right?
Yeah.
Or actually taking the last one. Which?
Of course, k cannot equal to zero, otherwise it becomes one.
Yeah, so, right. So what are the k? Oh, there exist these k's.
Yeah, there exist. One of them.
So you can pick one particular monomial and divide by the first one.
Yeah. Actually, you can prove that one monomial divide another, anyway is okay, anyway is the same.
So that means that so the KIs are not unique, right?
Not unique. Anyone.
Anyone, then they will have the same dimension.
Only exist one. There is one
that gives you n. The other will give you something else.
Yeah.
All right.
Note that these are n plus one element.
Right.
You can prove, of course, not easily, that you can choose any pair of monomials from one pi, and then get the quotient, then is the equivalent.
That's what I'm asking, right? Whether it's always n, whether the dimension, the different transcendence degree is always n.
So if it's not n, then this is not true. You cannot define a sparse result.
So you're saying if there exists k I, then for all k, all choices of k I?
Only one, there exists one. If there exists one, that's enough.
So for the other ones, the different transcendence may not be n, you're saying?
Yeah, you can easily give an example, it's not n, then
okay.
R does not exist. Of course, it's always less than or equal to n. It could be less than. That's a problem. Of course, a very simple example. I use a linear case. All the y1 double prime, and then these are all linear. Then of course, these are. This is the condition. The transcendental degree is equal to 2, of course. In this case, it's very simple. And then the sparse resultant do exist, and in this case, it does this determinant. Because it's linear, that's very easy.
So does that say some kind of independence
between
the PIs?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And also, to prove this, we basically use the intersection theory. And then we give a more intuitive criteria for the existence of sparse resultant. So as we still start with pi, we have n plus 1 pi's. And then, again, we consider this monomial, quotient of monomials. We just talk a little bit about this monomial. We can write it always in this way. We have n variables, and the order of is si, so it can be written in this way. The index is quite complicated and has four subscript. And then we introduce this d, symbol is not good. This d is not is different from the index. We introduce this polynomial. The index dikl becomes the coefficient, and then we introduce new variables. Now it's algebraic variable k, xkl, and then this belongs to xkl is the power. The l here is the order. You see, and the order of yk becomes the power of xk. And the power d I j k l becomes a coefficient. Then we got a univert polynomial in x k. Then the symbolic support vector of this Laurent monomial. This is basically a Laurent monomial. It's just denoted by this vector of their. So what we do is we try to give a single quantity, a single exponential quantity for this very complicated monomial, because it has orders, basically it's a vector, right? But we put them together by introducing a new variable, it becomes one quantity. So basically we can write something. So basically, that means So basically, we can write this monomial if you like. This monomial has I zero as y to the power of this beta. So basically, that's the way we want. Mm-hmm. Actually, we will do that later.
Yeah.
So this will make the simple, right? Very simple. Looks very simple. Otherwise, it's very complicated, right? Like that. Mm-hmm. But we can write it that's the way we do it. And then for the polynomial, this is only for one monomial. Then for the polynomial pi, we plus all their support vectors together with the same coefficient uij to get another vector. And then for all the polynomial, for the set of polynomial p0 to pn, we put them as the row of this matrix. So we got a matrix. This matrix has n plus 1 rows and n columns. So it's n plus 1 and n columns. So this matrix, each entry of the matrix is a polynomial of uij and x. For one column in the same xi, but for different columns x1, x2, xn. That's basically each one is a multivariate polynomial, but it's linear in uij. So we get a matrix of ordinary polynomial, not differential polynomial. So the result is that we got a result very much like linear algebra. Mm-hmm. The sparse result exists. That means I proved that the transcendental degree differential monomials is equal to n, even only if the rank of this matrix is n.
The rank in terms of multivariate polynomial in the x's.
Yeah. The rank is just the ordinary rank. The largest minors of the matrix has non-zero determinants. So this turned out to be the difficult theorem to prove in the paper. It takes about 15 pages to prove this theorem. This is a criteria for the to It's
What is the key part in the proof?
Pardon me?
Can you vaguely say what the key part in the proof is?
Yeah, the proof is we need to, like in linear algebra, we need to transform this matrix to some special form. But in the transformation, we need to keep the key property unchanged. Here is a differential transcendental degree.
Right.
We need to leave the transcendental degree of the differential polynomials unchanged. But you see, this is a multivariate polynomials inside.
Right.
Then we cannot do it into triangular form. We cannot do it into Hermite normal form.
Right.
But we did give a general form, general canonical form, but it's very complicated.
So is this an algorithm to compute the rank? Does it give
This is an algorithm, but I'm not sure whether this is the best algorithm. Because to compute the rank is also not easy.
Right.
We have a multivariate polynomial. But this do have applications, because with this, many results can be proved. That's what we... But I will not give the details of all the applications there. So basically, this is one of the main theory proofs. And then we're going to some properties of a partial of sparse differential resultant. The first result is we try to give a similar result to the Xiao resultant. So we consider whether the resultant gives sufficient and necessary condition for these PIs to have common zeros. So in this case, we specialize the coefficients UI to some concrete values like VI. VI belong to a differential field F. So PI becomes PI bar. So this becomes like ordinary polynomials we consider. So the first result is that this polynomial, if they have a non-polynomial solution, by that I mean it's not a polynomial of the variable t, of the
variable what?
Variable t.
Y.
The indeterminate term, not a y, t.
Not
the,
y.
Let's say the differential operator is t. Not a polynomial of t.
So that's rational solution in some way.
Yeah, something like that. Polynomial solution. If it, I will give example to example is here. If it has a non-polynomial solution, then the sparse result is zero. Why we consider non-polynomial solution? So here is the example. I use x. Here is the solution again. So of course the sparse resultant is not zero, right? Not zero. Mm-hmm. But since here is a triple prime, if we take y1 equal to x plus 1 and y2 equal to something like this, then all this become zero. Like you see, x plus 1 double two times and then it becomes zero, right? Already. This becomes zero. Then it has a solution, right? It has a solution. Then this are quite little bit different from the algebraic case.
So when you set the sparse resultant there, that's the generic one.
Yeah.
That's non-zero.
But
when you put in the V's, it is still non-zero. Are you saying that?
Yeah, but you see, this resultant only depends on the coefficients. You can always choose coefficients to that.
For any u.
You can easily to choose u such that.
You can choose u so that it's not zero.
But this
is a solution for anything.
Yeah, it always has a solution like this.
That's right.
Here is different from algebraic. Also, the difference case is also different. It's also not like this. This only happens in differential polynomial, because it's for polynomials like this, it's always zero.
Right.
Has nothing
right.
to do with the coefficients. So basically, right. This gives a necessary condition. For sufficient conditions, it's also somehow true. It's similar to the algebraic case, but not as good as that. So we consider again the differential polynomial. I already said that. After giving the polynomials, so we just need to give the coefficient. So basically, you can consider it as a affine space or projective space. You can consider all the differential polynomials with this AI as support as a affine space. Or basically, we write it as LAI. That means the coefficients are chosen arbitrary. Then we use Z0 to denote all those differential polynomials.
Wait,
have
wait,
common non-polynomial.
I suppose your CI should be CIJ?
CI. Let's see. CIJ is it's better. Here the it's not good. I should write something like this. I should write something like LAI is a vector of CI1, CI, LI. What is this? This is equivalent to the polynomial of CIJ.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
So basically, you can either write it as a polynomial or you can just take the coefficient out as a vector.
Right.
And this belongs to and then Z0 is all the coefficients, all the polynomials that has a non-polynomial solution.
Mm-hmm.
They will take the Cochin closure.
What do you mean by the Cochin differential closure?
Yeah, Cochin differential closure.
What do you mean by it?
It's basically because this
is an algebraic set.
These are embedded to doing it this way. These are embedded into the space.
Yeah.
Then I take the Cochin differential closure. So it becomes a differential orality. So basically, we can prove that the resultant, the sparse resultant with support a zero to an. Are they said this is the prime? This is the irreducible polynomial. This is the prime ideal. This is we take away the irreducible differential variety. This differential variety is basically this.
So this defined resultant of the support sets.
What do you mean?
So notation here, you're saying that it's a variety of a single of a saturation of an ideal generated by one single.
This is a resultant.
This is a definition, right?
No, this is not the definition.
Well, you define resolute.
Yeah.
Oh,
let me say, on the right-hand side, this is the resultant. That means the resultant is equal to zero, if and only if this polynomial has a solution. This gives a sufficient and none. On the right-hand side is a resultant. Here I read it. On the right-hand side is the resultant equal to zero. On the left-hand side is this polynomial, differential polynomial has a non-polynomial solution. So that means, this theorem means, this the vanishing of the resultant give a sufficient and
I'm just a little confused with your notation about the resultant. Sometimes the subscript is the monomial set, sometimes it is the polynomials, okay. F, and perhaps, I forgot, sometimes in P, right?
Yes.
Are they the same?
They're the same. Because it only depends on the monomial, right?
Right.
The coefficient
right.
is something important. So this still a little bit weak, weaker than the Sylvester or my colleague resultant, because for my colleague resultant, you do not need to take.
You do not.
The closure. Of course, it's in the homogeneous case, in the algebraic case, the result is that for homogeneous polynomials, if you consider it in the projective space, then these are exactly the same. You do not need to consider the closure. But in differential case, we cannot prove that. We try to prove that. Even in the simplest case of one variable, we cannot prove that. We can't prove that for homogeneous differential polynomials.
No, I suppose that maybe because that in your L of AI, you're only looking at the given differential polynomial in some sense, generic, yeah. But with some concrete coefficient as the solution set as your variety. But in the differential situation, when you have the P's, and when you look at the differential ideal, then you have a differentiator. You have to allow elimination of
them. Yeah, that's
why you have to take the closure, right?
Yeah. That's one reason. Anyway, so let's say that for this theorem, this is one of the theorems
mm-hmm.
we cannot do as good as algebraic case. Mm-hmm. Something is still left. But it might not be true. Because Cochin himself proved that differential projective space is not complete.
Right.
Maybe related with that, but I don't know. But currently we don't know. But that result cannot disprove this, what I want to prove. But somehow it can be related. Order, so we try to give the order of the differential resultant, this related to the Jacobian number here. So here I define the Jacobian number. So GIGN are differential polynomials. The Jacobian number is basically, I suppose everybody knows, so to take a permutation, sigma is a permutation of 1 to n. Then you take the order of GI with the variable of y sigma I, and then you plus them together, take the maximum for all the permutation sigma.
Okay, the parenthesis I is under the subscript, right?
Yeah, under the subscript. Yeah, yeah.
It's all of I,
that's under the subscript. It's the standard definition for Jacobian number. So the result here is something like this. If we consider not sparse, the first result is for differential resultant. That means all the monomials with degree less than or equal to something is given. If it's not sparse, then the differential resultant can be put to be differentially homogeneous in each UI, not in the whole U, but for each UI. And it is of order exactly of HI equal to S minus SI. Here S is all the SI plus together. S is, here I did not say S. S is the order of PI. S is the order of PI. SI is the order of PI. So that means in the dense case, we know the exact order. But in the sparse case, we can notice by S delta resultant. So it's also differentially homogeneous in each UI. But then the order, we do not know the exact order. We know a bound, the bounded Jacobian number, by just a delayed PI from the result. From the set, then this bound is actually quite optimal because of the another well known problem of the Jacobian number bound. So this bound are quite optimal. So also I cannot prove it, but I believe it's optimal. So for order bound we can get quite good. For orders of the resultant we can get very good bound. Of course, another well-known property of the resultant is this Poisson type product. These are the Sylvester, for Sylvester polynomials. The resultant of AXBX is just the product of A for all the roots of B. It's a Poisson product. For differential resultant, again, here is not dense, not sparse. For the dense case, we can prove that something like some very similar result. That the resultant can be written as a product of P0, the first polynomial. And then the eta 1 and the eta n are basically the generic points of P1, Pn. P1, Pn can be proved to be a zero-dimensional differential prime ideal. So quite similar to the So that's resultant. For sparse resultant, it gets a little bit tricky.
Okay, so you're looking, when you say that the aters is a generic point of this, you're looking at it algebraically, right?
No, differential. No. All differential.
Differential.
All differential.
You see that here,
I even have a H0, I did not say that. In the H0 here, that means P0 is get to all the order of different. P0 means, H0 means we need to differentiate H0.
But when you write, why is the aether double subscripted?
Because it has many of them. There are T0 of them. You see there? You need a product, right? They're quite
No, but the generic ones of P1 up to PN should have just N coordinates, because Y has N variables, right?
Yeah. Yeah, N variables, Y. Of course, I can just write it the coordinates. But here is multivariable, but the first line is only one variable. So it's just A eta. But here there is a multivariable, so I need it.
What is T0?
P0 is just one of the, when we consider sparse resultant, we consider resultant of P0, P1, Pn. It's just A and B, but here we consider N plus 1. So when we consider we use P0 and P all the way. Let's see the definition. Okay, P0. All the way.
Where is that?
The first line. Oh. P0, when we say resultant, we always say the resultant of P0 to Pn.
Right.
That's the P0.
What is T0? T0.
Oh, T0,
sorry. T0, not P, not me. T0, tau equals 1 to T0.
T0 is on the next slide, I will say that.
Okay.
In the sparse, I think, in the sparse case, it becomes a little bit tricky. So in order to get something similar to that, we need other assumptions like here are the two assumptions. So any n of pi are differentially independent, and their symbolic vector generates the whole space. The unit vector belongs to the module generated by these vectors. The alpha and divine alpha. Maybe I will skip this. So in the sparse case, in order to get something like this, we need a further result, so further assumptions.
All right.
But in the general case, it's pretty correct. So here I will define the T0.
The eta alpha. Can you hold on to that?
Here I see something that's not intended here.
Yeah, let's hold on to this page a little bit.
Yeah.
So the eta sub tau is a vector, and there are generic ones of this to a capital N. And what's a capital N? I think maybe it's too, all right, maybe it's too detailed. The bottom line.
This is because it's a Laurent polynomial, so n means we normalize the polynomial, we change it to an ordinary polynomial.
Ah, okay.
But then we need to make a quotient to get rid of all the polynomials. So this becomes a common ordinary polynomial. This is also a generic point of this. But I think I missed the definition of P0. Here is something. I think it should be here, but it's not.
It's all right. Let's move on.
But that's very critical. I need to define
it. I will use it later.
I will use that P0 later. P0 is the degree of P0 over y1 to the h0. H0 is the order of P0. That's, you take the highest order of y1, and then you take the degree of polynomial p0. This is a very important invariable.
So you single variable?
Oh yeah. Now it's algebraic variable, because we consider y1 to the order of h0. Now it's algebraic variable, so you can consider degree. This is a very important invariant. We will use it later. Here, very sorry, maybe miss up. I think one slice is not here. One slice is not here. So basically, these are called, we have a name, these are called leading. Anyway, that's P0. I will introduce it later. So now we give the degree bound. We have the order bound, and now we give the degree bound. Again, we consider P0, Pi, and the order of Pi is Si, degree of Pi is Mi. So this is our total degree, of course. So we have this order bound. This is like a Bizut type bound. It's also obtained with a Bizut type theorem of algebraic version of Bizut type theorem. But basically, we need this is a Bizut number, right? But we need to consider, we need to put the order here. Put the order, we need to multiply much more times. How many times is order hi plus one? Hi is order. Oh, sorry, here hi is si. Yeah, I think hi should be si here, sorry. Si should be si. So that's intuitively, so when you get the degree of R, you need to consider P0 and the P0 prime, P0 double prime as polynomials, and all the way to si plus one. Mm-hmm. Then consider them as a polynomial, then you use the Bizut theorem. Yeah. That's how it's proved. That's basically it. Then also, the resultant can be written as a linear combination of Pi and their derivative to the all the way to the S minus S. S is the sum of all, S is the sum of all these Si, has a linear combination. And more importantly, each part of this, here is H. All the parts of them, they have degree less than m plus 1, degree of R, and they can be written this way. So all this part can be bounded, has a degree bound. Not only R has a degree bound, all this red part. This is like Grobner basis, right? For Grobner basis, you know the bond, not only the left-hand side, also the right-hand side. These are important because maybe you try to use this, to compute the R. So how we do that? So we know the degree of R, right? We know the degree of R. Here is the degree of R. And then we also know the degree of this part. We know the degree of Pi, then we know the degree of Hi. So we just substitute them into it, then, and expand it. It becomes a linear equation, algebraic linear equation of the coefficients of R and H. And then we solve the linear equation, and then it is done. This is, of course, like a routine. This is a very typical result to solve problems, also to solve also to give complexity bound, especially to give complexity bound. These are very common. This is a very, very common method to give complexity bound. Fortunately, for the generic, for the dense case, for the non-sparse case, we can give a DKK bound, which is much better. So that's PI, a generic differential polynomial in Y with all the SI coefficients UI, and then here I define S. By generic, so here is no sparse, no the word sparse. That means result they have all the monomials of a degree less than or equal to something. Then the degree can be written as this very complicated variable, and M is the Minkowski mixed volume. Here QI, L is the Newton polytop of P, J to the order of L. As a polynomial, this Y1, this symbol means Y1, Y1 prime, Y1 double prime, all the way to S. This is a mixed volume. This is a typical PKK bound. We can prove this only for the dense case, not for the sparse case. If we have this for the sparse case, it will be very good, but we cannot prove it.
So what does BKK mean?
BKK is three people, like Bob Bernstein. K is, I think, the Russian. BKK, that's a three person.
Oh, BKK.
So they prove this theorem, which is better. In most cases, in the sparse case, is a better bound for the Bezout bound. For example, take this example. Since we consider n equal to 1, we have one variable. Order equal to 2, order equal to 1, s equal to 1, and degree equal to 2. So this gives two polynomials, differential polynomial, dense polynomial to the order 1 and degree 2. So if you use a Bezout type degree bound, it's equal to 81. And then if you use a BKK bound, the degree is 20. But you see, what I'm trying to say is that, interestingly, if you get rid of this term, then we do not know whether this bound is true or not. That's very, looks true, but cannot prove it somehow. I believe it's true, but I cannot prove it. That's so that's a...
Can you use... Is there a way to use a limit?
This is a specialization. This in order to prove it, the first have this bound for the whole, for the very large resultant. Then you try to set U0,4 to 0.
Right.
But this process becomes very complicated and difficult to analyze.
I mean, 0 may be difficult, but what about non-0?
If it's non-zero, then this is true. Let's say.
So it doesn't have to be generic, but it just cannot have zero.
If it's non-zero,
if the support is the same, would the result be the same when it's not generic?
If it's non-generic, then you do not have a degree, right? Do you still have a degree? Because when I say degree, I mean degree in terms of Uij. If Uij becomes a number, there is no degree. It becomes a number. R also becomes a number.
Okay.
Then this is what I already said this. So we can design average, basically, to compute R. This, we do it this incrementally, not all the way to the upper bound, and we do it a little bit from order 0, degree 2, degree 1, then all the way to the, because we know a bound, so it's terminate. So in the end, the complexity is something like this. M is the order to the power of n in the variable, number of variable. L is the size of the sparse result, and by that I mean the number of terms. S is the order. So this basically gives a single exponential algorithm to compute.
So arithmetic means no differentiation involved, right?
No, yes. We already considered differentiation. So So this is actually not bad, because for a differential algorithm, it's usually the complexity is usually very high. So this
double exponential.
Yeah, no, not even double. For characteristic set, Alexei has a paper, it's an Ackermann number.
Oh, my, okay.
It's an upper bound.
Of course, it's an upper bound.
It does not mean that it's actually that complex.
Yeah. But we do not have exactly better bound, right? It's given bound. Characteristic set is the ending condition, basically the length of the chain, right? And the length of the auto-reduced set. Then, by the way.
But you know, so with all these bounds, when you want to apply them to concrete examples, so you can consider how they grow asymptotically, but you have some concrete numbers involved. So it would make more sense to know what's behind the O, rather than how it grows asymptotically.
So yeah, of course.
You can have an Ackermann bound, but for some concrete values of what you put inside, it could be a very small number. And even smaller than some bound that is linear, but with some high constant. So it's really for concrete applications, not how it grows to the infinity, but what the actual number is.
Yeah, for this result, I believe is just a theoretical result. We do not use this algorithm to actually compute something. We better use the characteristic set. Because characteristic set, somehow, if the resultant is not that large, you can compute it. But for this algorithm, somehow we need to assume the worst case. That's not good. So this is basically a theoretical result. So basically we know we can eliminate n variables, n differential variables in a single exponential time. So basically we do not intend to really compute something with this.
When you say that you eliminate variables, well, you have some restrictions.
Oh
right, so
yes, that's the case. If we do not have, that's very important. That means if R is not zero, this will be true. If the resultant is not zero, this does give an elimination result, right? But R could be zero. So R could be zero, but still, because that's all the drawbacks of resultant,
right.
Even in the algebraic case, so R could become zero.
But when you're given a concrete situation, can you predict? So how much time does it take you to find out?
According to what we, but let me say. I say probability one because only you're very low dimension. Yes, I think it's true. Maybe it's true. And let me think. Because only a low dimension, a set of low dimension subset is. Let me see. I believe that's the case.
But if you have a system with some concrete coefficients and you would like to find out.
What do you mean? Are you still taking your coefficients of differential algebra to be independent or not?
No.
But that's the problem. The whole thing breaks down when you specialize the coefficients. Look at the anomaly of differential dimension.
Yeah. I suppose at the end you want to.
What I was going to ask you. What happens when you specialize?
What I try to say is that only in a subset which has a lower dimension or lower order, that the strange thing can happen. So in most cases, in probability one, it's true.
Yeah, that's what I was
wondering.
Really?
Yeah, but that is important for applications. But of course, some applications have degenerate. Degenerate pile, and can you find how much time would it take you to find out whether this is from the degenerate pile?
That's of course is an interesting topic. We're trying to do that actually, but not let me say this, in the algebraic case, that also happened. But then there is one paper by John Kenney, you know, very long time ago, maybe 1991 or 1990. He introduced this generalized, we call it a generalized character polynomial, something like that. Then that can be, somehow can be dealt with.